Well, good morning. It's good to have you here with us this morning. If you're home tuning in, hope this message finds you well. We have been in much prayer for the people that are sick around us. We hope that God's providence shows through and the great physician shows up and takes care of you. But as we look here today, we're going to be looking at one of my favorite subjects, liberty. And I live in the greatest country in the world. I live in the United States of America, and I assure you, we have many, many liberties. But here in the past few weeks, since the pandemic struck, some of those liberties have been taken away a little, haven't they? You have to have a piece of paper to go from point A to point B, and you have to be labeled essential. Well, that's kind of tough for an American to swallow, because he's used to going and coming just exactly when he pleases. But we're going to be looking at liberties this morning. As you find your place there in the Bible with me, in Galatians 5, we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 12 this morning. And we're going to be talking about just that, liberty, freedom, if you will. So verse 1 says, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not as entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Behold, I, Paul, say to you, that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised, that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Christ is become no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. For we, through the Spirit, wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith, which worketh perfect by love. Ye did run well. Who did hinder you that ye should not obey the truth? The persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. I have confidence in you through the Lord that ye will be none otherwise minded. But he that troubleth you shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. And I, brethren, if I yet preach circumcision, why do I yet suffer persecution? Then is the offense of the cross ceased? I would that they were even cut off, which trouble you." Why? Apostle Paul, kind of in some situations here, kind of softening his rebuke a little bit, but have no doubt about it. He's dead serious about liberty. And so am I. I love the liberty I have in Jesus Christ. Have no doubt about it. I cannot stand up to the law. And what he's saying here essentially is that if you're under the law, and we're talking to Christians today, I'm not talking to you if you're lost, because you are under that law. And I don't just mean one point of that law. I mean each and every point of that law. You're absolutely under. You're not in Christ. You're under the law. And what he's saying to believers here is that you can't be both ways. You've got to either be under grace, which thank God that we are, or you're going to be under the law. Paul starts right out saying, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free." Wow. How did Christ make you free? How did Christ make me free? When I accepted him as my Savior, I took on his cloak of righteousness. His blood covers my sin. His blood covers your sin if you're in Christ. Again, if you're not in Christ, you're under the law. Remember, he fulfilled the law. When he said, "It is finished," on the cross, that's exactly what he meant. It was totally finished. And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Well, the yoke of bondage has always been and will always be the law. Listen, time and time again, the Jewish people, the Israelites, tried to fulfill the law. They failed every single time. Now, these guys were not joking around. Think about it. They tithe on the herbs in their garden. I mean, show me a Christian today that tithes on the herbs that he gets out of his garden. You don't see very many people like that. They were not messing around. If they tried to keep the law, there was absolutely nothing they could do to keep it. If they kept one point, another point, they failed. So if you fail one point, look, this is not a majority gets an A test. If you fail one point of the law, you're guilty. God's going to judge you and send you to that place called hell. I'm sorry if you're tuned in today. This is a Baptist church. We say hell quite often here. And I do mean a literal place. It has a literal address. The fire of the torment, of their torment, will ascend forever and ever. You know how high that is? That's a long way up. So you can imagine what goes on in that place we call hell. Huh? It has a literal address. Don't be confused about it. Don't believe in some washed out religion. Christ talked more about hell when he was here than he did about heaven. Think about it. He's serious about it. He wants you to know about it. But don't let me get off the subject here. The yoke of bondage is what we're talking about, and that is the law. Man could not keep it. The law was designed for one thing. One thing only. It was to show you, the sinner, and me, the sinner, that we cannot keep God's moral law. We cannot do it. You and I can't live up to the law. We cannot do it. Now, I know there's people in churches all across the land that say they keep the law. Brother, come and see me. Let's spend the day together and we'll find out how many laws you break in a day. They can't keep the law. We never could keep the law. It was designed for one thing, to show us that we need an all-sufficient Savior. And we have one in Christ. But these people here were, they were confused by these Judaizers. These Judaizers were saying, yeah, you need Jesus, but you need to do something. Paul's going to talk about circumcision here to go with Jesus. Listen, that's not the gospel. If my Savior did not cover every one of my sins, I don't have a Savior. If it's Jesus plus anything, that's not the gospel. What did he say in chapter 1? He said, let that person that says it takes Jesus plus something else be damned, be condemned. Look, Paul wasn't clowning around. He's serious about this. He's serious about you keeping the gospel pure. If you're somewhere, someone's teaching you it takes Jesus plus some act of work on your part, run. That's not fact. That's not the Jesus we serve. That's not the gospel. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you, verse 2, if ye be circumcised, Christ shall not profit you anything. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to the whole law. The Judaizer was saying, yeah, it takes Jesus, but we want you to do this one little tiny thing. Get circumcised. That's what we want you to do. No. Paul's saying that is not the gospel. It is not the gospel. It'll never be the gospel. It's Jesus and his grace alone. That's what it is. It cannot be anything plus Christ. That does not equal the gospel. Paul can't emphasize it enough here. Christ has become of no effect unto you. Verse 4. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, you are fallen from grace. Wow. That falling from grace there, doesn't it just kill you? Kind of puts a little terror in my thinking. You know, I'm no Baptist. I believe once you're saved, you're always saved. But this falling from grace, I've kind of lost my place here. This falling from grace, the Christian there that he's talking about, the believer, okay? Again, we're not talking to the unbelievers. How do I know this? 9 times he's called them brethren. Several other times he's called them we. Now, he would not do that to a lost man. So we're talking to Christians. So the question here for the novice, see, he says, well, see right there, you can fall from grace. No. You fall from the sphere of God's blessings. But your status as a saved child of God never changes. Now, I'm telling you what, you'll suffer because you won't be experiencing the full blessings of God. And I promise you, He's going to hold you responsible if you're teaching something other than the true gospel. But I'm telling you, if you're a child of God, you're always going to be a child of God. You cannot fall from grace. But you can fall from the blessings of God's spear of grace. You know, you and I, we go about teaching and telling people about Jesus. There's a lot of grace involved in that. Sometimes we might not say exactly the right thing. Don't be dissuaded. I promise you what you're saying about Christ is getting through to that person. Don't be dissuaded about that. But there he's using some really strong language. It kills me when people tell me, oh, I'm backslidden. God, kick me to the curb. No. No. They've got it a little backwards. They kick God to the curb. He's right where you left him. He's standing right beside you. He say, I'll never leave you. I'll be closer than a brother. Christ has never left you. You just need to repent of whatever sin you've chosen over God and turn back to Christ. He's standing right there. As far as falling from grace, falling back into some sinful state, no. No, we don't fall there. Christ forgave my sins, past, present, future. The picture is I've been saved, I'm being saved, and I will be saved. Get right. Stop living a life of fear. You know, we as people, I guess, our fallen state allows fear to come into our life. You see so many people fearful of coronavirus. Sure, it's a very debilitating sickness. Now, I agree with that. It's rough. And it's killing a few folks in America, a lot of folks worldwide. But are you to live in a state of fear of that disease? No. No. God never gave you a spirit of fear. If you've got fear in your heart, then that's Satan working in your life, kicking to the curb. If you get it or if you don't, and if it kills you or if it doesn't, you're a winner either way if you're a Christian. You haven't fallen from... You're either a child of God or you're not. There's no two ways about it. You need to understand here. Don't live in a state of fear. 365 times in your Bible, at least, it says fear not. What else does he need to say to you? You're not to have fear. You're not to live in fear. And these Judaizers here were continually trying to make the new believers there in Galatia believe that they were not Christians. They say, well, you know, it takes this. It takes Jesus plus this. No. Again, that's not right. That's not the truth. You know, we've proved over and over again that here, that the law cannot make a Christian. Those are commandments that we're to live by and not to break if we can absolutely avoid it. We're called to be Christ-like, that's the word, Christian, Christ-like, more and more every day. He didn't break the law when he was here, did he? Now, does that mean you won't? No, that does not mean that. That absolutely does not mean that. But does it mean that God's going to hold it to your account when it comes to judgment day? It means that he's not going to hold it to your account come judgment day. He's going to charge it to Jesus, who paid for it already on the cross at Calvary. Don't get jammed up in this. We're saved by grace. End of story. This grace is sufficient to get you through anything. What's God say? Several times. My grace is sufficient. My grace is sufficient. And I'm not talking about the grace of your best friend. No. I'm not talking about the grace of your pastor. I'm not talking about the grace of the President of the United States. I'm talking about the grace of God being sufficient for anything that you get into. Listen, if he's put it in your life or on your heart to teach the gospel, do it. His grace will see you through it. If he's put it on your heart to be a missionary, you should do it. Don't be disobedient. If he's put it on your heart to be an usher, you should do it. His grace is sufficient. We serve an all-sufficient Savior And he bought and paid for you and me. He bought us out of slavery. All right, out of the law. You're not even under the law anymore. He bought you out of the law, out of the state of the law, under grace. Please get this right. Don't live like you're a Pharisee. Don't live under the law. See, maybe taking a deep breath back there. I must be getting to it. Do not live under the law. For in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision availeth anything, 6, nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love. You know, when you first got saved, you didn't think about the Bible, did you? Not much. You might know John 3:16, my favorite verse, but you didn't know much about the Bible. But through grace, you knew in your heart that God had forgiven you, right? And he changed who you were inside. You no longer wanted to do the terrible, terrible things that you used to do. You no longer had the desire, and I'm not saying it happened overnight, to be a drunkard or a drug addict, but I'm saying that a work occurred in your life. I'm saying that you changed from who you were to who you are today. The old sinner saved by grace. And that's all we all are. We're forgiven by God Almighty. That's what the deal is. That's grace. Unmerited favor. You get that. I get that. We don't deserve it. Christ paid for it. That's why I say we don't deserve it. Christ paid the debt that you and I couldn't pay. If you were still under the law, it's a good thing his iPad's got me locked up here because I'd come outside here. I can't hardly stay up here. If you were under the law, you would be bankrupt and waiting judgment before God Almighty today. If you're under the law, think about it. If you're under the old Mosaic law, you today are awaiting judgment from God himself. You'd have to be a lost person to do that. And despite our best efforts, and I assure you, we are trying our best to get the word out to people, but there's somebody that's going to go and be judged in front of a holy God. And I shudder to think, I'm not scared of much, I shudder to think of that day. I know we're going to see it. I know we're going to see the life portrayed there in front of the king. I know we're going to see that person trying to defend his life and what he's done in it under the law, under the Mosaic law. I know we're going to see it. I can tell you we're going to see it. The difference will be, it'll be unadulterated. It'll be absolute fact. And you'll see every second of that person's life. Every time he made a decision not to accept Christ, you'll see it. Our God is a righteous God. I promise you, he's as much righteousness as he is love. So when the guy gets to the end of his case, he's going to send him to hell. Because you cannot keep the law. And if you fail in one point, look, God is not blind. He is not like Lady Justice here in America. He does not wear a blindfold. You're confused if you think that. He knows every single thing you do and your motive behind it. I said it right. I did not stumble. Your motive, your heart motive behind it. He knows it. If you think for one second you can attain his mercy through your life, and I know you might think you've lived a great life, and I pray you have. But I'm telling you, it's a wasted life if you haven't accepted Christ today. It's an absolute waste of life. You're not going anywhere but that place called hell. You did run well. Look there, 7. You did run well. Where did that come from? Kind of an off thing to say. Paul relates a lot of things to running the race, right? Now, you know, we as Americans, we love sports, right? We love sports. Well, Paul did too. And you know, in the Olympic Games, we see people competing. But in Paul's day, you had to be a citizen to compete in the games. Well, You became a citizen when you accepted Christ. Okay? But why do we run the race? We don't run the race to be saved. You're saved prior to running the race. You're saved when you don't even know anything about running the race, right? The Lord puts us on our course, and we do run to win the prize. We don't run to be saved. We run because we are already saved and want to fulfill God's will in our life. That's why we run. That's why we go to church on Sunday to see what's on the spiritual table for us to eat. That's why we go out and talk to unsaved people. It's why you do what you do. It's not to be saved. Look, at the moment I accepted Jesus Christ, every sin I ever committed, every sin I'll commit today, and every sin that will be committed to the end of my life was covered. It was paid. Jesus paid. I didn't pay it. I couldn't afford it. I was bankrupt. But in Christ, I'm not bankrupt. In Christ, I'm a joint heir with Him. I get to experience all of His endless riches, and I assure you, He has a lot. Think about it. The Bible says they're unsearchable. That means you can't figure out all of them that He has. So Christ sets us on a road here to race, and you know we've got people. We've got people that they swerve out of their lane into someone else's lane. You know when a runner is running a race at the games, they've got a lane to stay in. Well, if they get out of their lane and crowd someone else's, well, you know they're going to have to pay a little bit of a penalty. And these Judaizers, they were really a messed up group of people. They were trying to get the new believer, the believer that is saved by grace, okay? Christ's grace and nothing else. The work that He did was finished, okay? That grace is the grace I'm talking about. They were saying, no, we want you to be circumcised. No, you need to keep the feast. No, it's Jesus plus this. Look, when it's Jesus plus anything run, okay? I don't care who you're listening to. I don't care. I don't care who tells you that. I don't care if it's your mom that tells you that run. Say, no, Mom, that's not right. Pick the Bible up. It's not Jesus plus anything that does anything. It's just Jesus. That's the gospel. But God sets us on these races that we run, and the Judaizers would definitely try to interfere with the running of that race. You know, it was a new church. Think about it. New church plants, they go through a lot of problems. I mean, you know, they get a group of people together that all have different ideologies about how a church should work, and they encounter problems. Whereas most of the time, it all come down to some legalistic rule that someone is or is not keeping. Be very, very careful of that. This persuasion. You did run well. Who hindered you that you should not obey the truth? Okay, so he's asking them a question. You know, these Judaizers, they're not out in the public. They don't want to take Paul on man to man. They'll lose the debate. Okay, when they open their mouth, they've already lost against the Apostle Paul. He knew that it was by grace and grace alone. Don't believe anything else. These Judaizers was wanting them to do a work of the law, right? And Paul's saying, who that ye should not obey the truth? This persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. What's he saying? These things did not come from Christ. These things come from a legalistic person. There's so much danger in the church today. We've got to be really, really careful. You know, the child of God should be more Christ-like every day. When you say, Brother Mark, don't that mean meeting the law? No. No, it doesn't mean meeting the law. You should knowingly try to break the law. You should try to live by the law. But God's grace is sufficient to solve all the issues of the law. He gives another example here. The Bible is giving it every time. Usually when it says leaven in the Bible, It represents evil. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. What's he saying? One legalistic person in the crowd that says, "Ah, Brother Mark, he can't be saved. He's not circumcised." I tell you, shame on you. Who are you, old man? You hear me? Who are you, old man, to judge another man's servant? That's exactly what I would say to you. That's what I am saying to you today. You have no right, no right to judge another man's servant. Christ's servant, you don't have a right to judge him. You don't have a right to make him get circumcised. You don't have these rights. These rights come from God himself. Jesus Christ said, "My grace is sufficient." I promise you, it is utterly sufficient. We don't have to go through a ritual of getting circumcised. We don't have to do those things. And one person in a group of people saying these things, in a congregation saying these things, yes, Jesus, plus something else, will destroy a congregation. Write it down and call me a liar. I have confidence in you that through the Lord that you will be none otherwise minded. But he that troubleth you shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. See right there, whosoever he be. Paul don't know who they are. So they're running around in little back rooms. They're running around behind the church's back. The new church there, Galatia, they're running around behind their back saying, "Oh, it's Jesus plus something else." No. Please say no. If it's Jesus plus anything else, I don't want it, because that's not the gospel. But that's what they're doing. He doesn't know exactly who to debate with, but he knows they're doing it. Paul knows that they're poisoning the flock, and it's a poison that seeps into a flock of people. It's a poison that seeps into the congregation. And know this. It's not that you're lost. I'm not saying you're lost. I'm not your judge. I am saying you're out of the will of God. If you're adding or taking away anything from the gospel, read the Bible. You cannot add or take away anything from the gospel. I am saying that to you today. If you're saying it's Jesus plus something else, you're wrong. "And I, brethren, if I yet preach circumcision, why do I yet suffer persecution? Then it is the offense of the cross ceased." Look, Paul was still being beaten and attacked and for the cause of the Christ. Look, Jesus never said, "Mark, Brother Mark, look here. I'm gonna save you from an eternity in hell, and your walk's gonna be all roses and peachy. That'll even come out of my mouth right, peachy. Until you come home." No, he never promised that. He promised me trial and tribulation when I accepted him. That's what he promised. He promised that in the end, I'll have a mansion prepared by his hands. That's what he promised me. He promised me not that I would get what I deserved. He promised me that I would not get what I deserved, and that I would spend eternity in a place called heaven with him. That's what he promised. But we are going to go through trial and tribulation here. You have got to safeguard the people you're around, your loved ones, from anything that is Jesus plus something else. It cannot be okay. You've got to stay, you've got to draw a line in the sand and say, "No, you're not coming this far." Paul was still being persecuted. Listen to the last verse here. "I would that they were even cut off which trouble you." You know, that's strong language. What is he saying? I wish they were gone. I don't care how. I don't care where they go. And you know the apostle didn't want someone else's blood on his hands. And what's he talking about? He's saying, "Look, I would that no man's blood be on my hands." What's he mean? He's meaning that he doesn't want to go to heaven and God say, "Well, why didn't you witness to Joe Bloke?" Why not, Paul? So for him to make this statement, "I would that they were even cut off which trouble you." Wow. Paul's not clowning around here. He's telling us right there. And I want to close today, and I know I've been a little long-winded, but I want you to understand. God's grace is sufficient every single time. We are forgiven of our past sins, our present sins, and our future sins. It never ever takes Jesus plus something else to save your soul. Get this right. It takes Jesus Christ and his love alone and what he did on the cross as a substitution for what you do in your life. That's what it takes. It takes you accepting that. What does he say? Yeah, stand at the door and knock. He's right there right now. If you don't believe in him, he's there waiting for you to accept him. You know, this is the time. Today is the appointed time. Today is the appointed hour. It's not tomorrow. You're not promised tomorrow. You're not promised 30 seconds from now. But I know, me personally, I know my Savior. I know who I've trusted in. I know that as the moment I close my eyes in death, he'll be there to get me. If Corona takes me out tomorrow, listen, I'm a winner either way. If I go or if I stay, believe it. You guys need to stop living in fear. Remember, God's grace is sufficient for every demand of life. We're saved by grace, right? Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. We serve by grace, 1 Corinthians 15, 9 through 10. Grace enables us to endure suffering, 2 Corinthians 12, 9. It is grace that strengthens us, 2 Timothy 2, 1. So that we can be victorious soldiers. Our God is the God of all grace, 1 Peter 5, 10. We can come to the throne of grace and find grace to help in every need. Hebrews 4:16, as we read the Bible, which is the word of his grace, the spirit of his grace. Hebrews 10:29 reveals to us how rich we are in Christ. And of his fullness, all we have received, grace and the grace. John 1:16, how rich are you today? He gave you an example. And I probably went through that hurriedly. He gave you an example of everything that could possibly happen in your life that he would show you exceedingly large amounts of grace to get you through it. And in the end, listen, this is the killer. I know how it ends. In the end, we're going to be in heaven with him for all eternity. In a mansion he prepared, has gone to prepare for you and me. Think about it. Christianity is the only organized, and I shudder to say, religion out there. Doesn't ask you to do anything. Doesn't ask you for anything. It asks you to accept Jesus Christ's payment for your sins on the cross. Really? That's it. It's just exactly that simple. Christ didn't want it complex. Think about this. Christ wanted it simple. He was lowly. He was meek. He was mild of temper. I never said weak. Don't you ever get confused. I said meek. Never weak. But he's an all-sufficient Savior here for us today. Grace is extended to you, but grace is not extended to you to the point that you can pervert the gospel. Don't do it. I promise you, you're going to pay for it when you do. Please don't do it. Please keep the gospel pure like it was intended. Don't add Jesus plus something else. It is never plus something else. And I know I've beat you up with Jesus plus something else, but if you don't get anything else out of this, get that. If it's Jesus plus something else, it is not the gospel. It is not the saving gospel that will save your soul. Please don't be around that. It's hypocritical. It's not the gospel. I want you to pray with me, and we're going to close today. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time that we've been together. Lord, we pray for your continuing protection in this dangerous time. Lord, we also pray for your strength, that we can make it through this time and that we can somehow give you the glory and honor for getting us through it. And Lord, we just pray for all those here at First Baptist that are at home. Lord, I pray you keep a hedge of protection around them as they try to stay home and stay well. And Lord, we ask that you would bless all these things in Jesus' name.